Okay, I think we're just about ready to start up. Once again, for those of you who are just joining, this is Investigational New Antiretrovirals, What's Hot? I'm Joe Eron. I'm a professor of medicine at the University of North Carolina in Chapel Hill. My disclosures are on this slide that at the very beginning here. Here's your CME information. It's all online, but it is 1.25 hours of AMA PRA credit. And it's been approved not only for CME, but ABIM, maintenance of certification. You can see nursing, pharmacotherapy, and pharmacy contact hours. So, and again, all this information is online. These are our supporters that help make this possible, but this activity is obviously 100% generated by the IAS-USA team and me without influence from supporters. So remember navigating the webinar, there are poll questions. A separate window will show the poll question and you wanna choose your response. And the responses do come up. We are gonna have the pre and post test, so the hopefully I'll be able to teach you something today and you'll learn something new. You can submit questions. I'll try to keep track of that, but we should have, I think, plenty of time at the end for questions. I think that's probably best. I may not be able to get all the questions, but I'll absolutely do my best. So the first poll is just rate your level of experience in the medical management of HIV infection. So on the left is a novice, and on the right, a five is an expert. So why don't you go ahead and vote. Okay, so really, I'm pretty evenly split, but the largest number is people who would rate themselves a four. So lots of pretty expert people, which is good, because I think this is really what we're trying to get at here. So that's great. And for people who are novice, don't worry. If you don't know the answers to the questions, it's okay. I am having a little trouble advancing my slides. Okay, let me go down here and see if that works. Okay, so here I am again. Here are the learning objectives. You can read them, but basically we're gonna describe why new antiretrovirals are needed, and we're gonna talk about pre-treatment and prevention. I want you to be able to list at least two antiviral agents that work by new mechanisms when we get done. And then summarize possible ways that these long-acting antiretrovirals might be administered or used in the future. So, and here are pretest questions. So you're gonna vote here, but which is true about lenacapavir? Lenacapavir, an investigational HIV capsid inhibitor. So it binds to a human protein that stabilizes HIV capsid. It blocks multiple capsid-dependent steps in the HIV life cycle. It does not select for resistance mutations in vitro, or it can only be given subcutaneously. So there's only one right answer here. You're not expected to know it right now, but I'd like you to vote. Great. You are a pretty sophisticated audience. Thank you. Okay, next. So I got to close my little window. Next. Which of the following studies for HIV treatment and prevention are ongoing or planned for the novel agent islatravir? So which of these studies are either ongoing or planned? A daily oral therapy and as a long-acting implant, daily, weekly, and monthly oral therapy, and studied as a subcutaneous injection, daily, weekly, and monthly oral therapy in a long-acting implant, or weekly and monthly oral therapy and as an IM intramuscular injectable. Go ahead and vote. All right, terrific. Okay, so let's get into it. So here are the goals of antiretroviral therapy. I think everybody would agree with these goals. Some of them we're getting very good at, but certainly having therapies that are accessible to all people living with HIV and prevent transmission of HIV to others via any route of exposure. And again, to reach all people that are at risk. And that's some of what we're trying to do with our new therapies. So this is a slide created by Raj Gandhi. So what do we need? Well, I think the first need is fewer drugs. And by that, can we maintain people or treat people with fewer agents? Is two drugs or maybe someday even one drug going to be sufficient if we have the right drug? I think for everybody, having drugs with very limited toxicity is critical. I think that maybe the biggest check marks might be in reducing dose frequency, and I'll talk a lot about that. We do want drugs that have a high barrier to resistance. And though the number of people that have multi-drug resistance that need a new drug is small, we know from our experience, our long experience, that the best way to rescue those people are with new drugs that work by new mechanisms. People unfortunately are still impacted by stigma, and therefore therapies that help avoid disclosure in sensitive settings would be useful. We need drugs that are safe during pregnancy. And I think lower cost and better access will really make a difference for people living with HIV. So there are some new agents that are no longer investigational. They've been approved. Fostemsavir is an oral prodrug of Temsavir. It's an HIV attachment inhibitor, and it's been approved for highly treatment experienced patients. It is twice daily oral therapy. It's well tolerated, and people are starting to get used to using it. It's certainly active against resistant variants, and perhaps it's not yet been studied in this way, could be used to replace more complex or less tolerated therapy, and that may be a way it could get used in the future. And then our most recent new therapy that's been approved is the combination of cabotegravir plus rilpivirine is a long-acting injectable. This is an intramuscular injectable every 4 weeks or once a month is how it's approved. It's for people who are suppressed on oral therapy and haven't previously failed therapy. And it requires right now, at least in the package insert, an oral lead-in therapy, but it's fewer agents, it's reduced dose frequency, it might reduce stigma. But right now it's lots of kind of medical visits, because right now it's either given in a clinic or potentially maybe by a pharmacist in a fast med type situation, but it's not a home therapy at this point. So it will likely get approved to be given every 2 months, and that's the data that was presented at CROI. This Atlas 2M compared 1 month versus 2 months of therapy. And you can see they were very, very similar in terms of keeping people suppressed and very few virologic failures. You can see over to the left-hand side of the slide, but numerically a few more in the every 8 week, which is the dark green as opposed to the speckled green. But certainly it met the a very strict non-inferiority margin in terms of proportion with viremia, and also was obviously non-inferior in terms of keeping people suppressed with 90% or more of people staying suppressed in this particular study, comparing every 8 weeks with every 4 weeks. What is different, and not common, but different, is that there are more confirmed virologic failures with the every 8 week, eight versus two in the course of ATLAS II, and more resistance. Six of the eight failures had rilpivirine RAMs. Five of the eight had integrase RAMs. And so there is some cost. I mean, obviously it's in the 1% range in terms of resistance emergence, but it is there. If you looked at kind of predictors, the strongest predictor by far was a previous history or documentation by resistance testing or DNA resistance testing of pre-existing rilpivirine resistance. And that's not surprising, because that means the person was then given a cabotegravir monotherapy. But other things like obesity, and there was a slight difference by female sex. Those are potential issues. These injections do cause pain. I think probably everybody on the call knows that. But most of these injection site reactions are mild or moderate, and the median duration was 3 days. And people on the study who transitioned from oral therapy preferred being on injectables over oral therapy. That's not too surprising. And those who had been previously on every 4 weeks preferred every 8 weeks. And that also is not surprising, but we're not gonna recommend this therapy for someone who doesn't want it. That doesn't make sense. I think that's a plus. So let's get into like investigational agents. So this was just presented in the fall in Glasgow. This is a new NNRTI. So this is a non-nuke MK8507. And what's unique about it is it has the PK pharmacokinetic support to be a once weekly dose. So it has a half-life of 70 hours in humans. It's generally well tolerated at single doses and up to three weekly doses so far. And what you can see on the right is its antiviral effect. And you can see with a single dose, so not with multiple doses, but with a single dose, you can see an antiviral effect that is over a log between 10-fold to 30-fold over what's 168 hours? You do the math. That's 7 days. It is an active antiviral, and it needs a partner. And we're going to talk about islatravir in just a minute or two, because islatravir is a potential once a week partner for this long-acting NNRTI. But so far, we don't have any multiple dose treatment data with this agent. We have some safety data, but not treatment data. So that's the new drug that we have being developed clinically in an existing class. Now I'm going to talk about two new agents that are in new classes. First is islatravir. So islatravir is a nucleoside reverse transcriptase translocation inhibitor. So it looks a little bit like a nuke. It's certainly shaped like a nuke. If you look over up here on the upper right-hand side of the slide. But what it does, it basically has a bend in it. So when it's incorporated into the growing viral DNA by the reverse transcriptase, it actually blocks the ability of this viral DNA that's being transcribed from sliding. It can't slide anymore, so it can't translocate. And then it also works as a chain terminator. You remember that's how our nucleosides work. So it actually works by two mechanisms. And it may be what leads to the very, very high potency of this drug. It's an extremely potent drug, and I'll show you that in a minute. It has a long half-life, 128 hours, so once per week dosing. It has nanomolar potency in the lab. It does select for M184V, which is interesting. It does that both in vitro and in macaque models using a SHIV variant. But in those same models, it actually maintains activity. So it selects for 184V, but it maintains activity against viruses with M184V. So there's a potential for once weekly dosing with a very potent agent. And here's an example. This is one dose, again, not daily dose, but a single dose. And as little as half a milligram produces over a log effect. And as you get up to 10 or 30 milligrams, you get almost a 2-log effect over a 10-day period. So a once weekly 10 or 30 milligram dose is likely to provide very potent activity. And again, I mentioned that it has this long half-life. So here's an agent that may have the ability to be given once weekly for therapy. So remember, islatravir once weekly for therapy. It's also being studied once daily with doravirine, which is an NNRTI. So once daily, and in that study, it's 0.75 milligrams a day. And one big advantage of a very, very potent drug is that you can get a lot of active drug in a small pill, but also in other forms. The other thing that is important and interesting about islatravir is it's very active against resistant viruses. So this is islatravir MK8591. This is the activity level, and this is in nanomolar, so 0.1 nanomolar. That's very, very potent, obviously. And you can see against wild type, you can see with M184V, the susceptibility drops, but it's still 1 nanomolar. And then you look at all these various resistant viruses, you can see that for the most part, with a couple of exceptions, mainly the 69 insert, all the IC50s in vitro, this is in the lab, are at 1 nanomolar or below. So very active drug. And then what you could see too is that because this can be concentrated, because it's so potent in a small nexplanon like applicator. So this is the same tube that's used for long acting contraceptive like nexplanon or implanon. And to get a sense of the size of this, if you put 2 pennies side by side, that's about how big that is. And what you can see, this is again just presented at CROI just a week or so ago, or 2 weeks ago now. What you can see is that these implants have a long duration of therapy, 48 milligrams, 52, 56 milligrams. Here's the threshold, which we think of activity. You can see well above that. Now, this study was done only for 12 weeks, and then the implant was removed. But if you do a model and say, well, what if we hadn't removed the implant? The prediction is that this implant would last at least 6 months and potentially a year. So here's islatravir orally once a day, orally once a week, and potentially either for prevention or treatment by implant once every 6 months or once a year. So that's something that we're looking forward to. And I'll in a minute or two, I'll talk about how these drugs are being studied in the clinical studies that have been done. So lenacapravir is a capsid inhibitor. The HIV capsid is a really super interesting structure. It's interesting, you know, in our cell, we have all these things that really function as tiny machines or tiny structures. And in the case of capsid, it's a structure. And in order, it needs to be intact to enter the cell. And this diagram is actually probably not correct. We learned at CROI with a beautiful presentation that the capsid actually, the HIV RNA is probably reverse transcribed while still being associated with capsid. In fact, if capsid breaks up too early, then the virus is inhibited. And the capsid carries the reverse transcribed DNA all the way to the nucleopore. So the capsid probably even enters the nucleus and then deposits the double-stranded HIV DNA there and then is integrated, as everybody knows. And then the capsid is really important as the virus is assembling. And once the virus buds from the cell, it kind of self-assembles. So the capsid kind of pulls itself together. I've cut up wood in my garage and tried to get it to self-assemble, but it never does. But the capsid does self-assemble, which is kind of remarkable. And only fully assembled capsid is infectious. So even though this particular variant over here has all the parts, if it doesn't assemble, it doesn't work. So lenacapavir blocks viral replication at multiple steps. So here you can see that it blocks this structure disassembly. So it forces the capsid to go into be ubiquinated and essentially go down the drain in the cell. So that blocks replication. It blocks virus production and it blocks capsid assembly. And this drug is also very, very active at the picomolar level. So picomolar is 10 to the minus 12. So a very small number, 50 picomolar. So very active. And that's because it blocks HIV replication at multiple steps. And because it's so potent. And also because of its structure, it can be formulated as a subcutaneous dose. So given this is a single subcutaneous dose, and you can see that it has a very potent activity, again, out to 2.3 logs. So that's about 200-fold drop. In this particular study, this was presented over a year ago by Eric Dar. And at this point, all the participants went on BFTEF, but you can see even 20 milligrams had a potent effect. So it can be given subcutaneously. And when it was first being developed, it was actually thought that, well, maybe it can only be given subcutaneously. But as it turns out, it can be given both orally and subcutaneously. Now it is kind of, it is an interaction with a protein. It's not an enzyme inhibitor, right? It's interacting with a protein structure. So you can select for resistance in vitro. So remember that you can select for resistance in vitro. And you can see selection experiments have been done and you can see that you can get low level resistance and the virus replicates pretty well. If you get this high level resistance, it's very hard to get the virus to replicate at all. So there's a fitness hit. And whoops, I'm sorry, I went the wrong direction. When people have looked at the capsid sequences of over 1,500 clinical isolates, and you don't find these mutations existing in the wild, so to speak. So they almost all certainly have some fitness hit. Not surprising, there's no cross resistance with integrase or RT inhibitors and no cross resistance with protease inhibitors. And it's active against all HIV subtypes. And there are some references that you can look at. And this was this resistance data was presented at CROI just several weeks ago. What we do know though is at the lowest doses, remember if we go back to here, doses up to 750 milligrams were tested subcutaneously. But if you look at these lower doses, 20 and 50, There actually was selection for resistance, even over the short period of time before the BF-TAF was started. Very potent effect. You see this drop of two logs, but then they did find a resistance mutation. Now, this is one of those mutations that has a very small decrease in susceptibility. And so it's not surprising that maybe the most fit variant with a small decrease in susceptibility was selected for with a low dose. At a high dose, you probably wouldn't select for that this mutation because your concentrations would be too high. So if you give a single subcutaneous dose, it has a very long half-life. This is six-fold above the IC95, so not above the IC50, but above the IC95. And you can see with a single subcutaneous dose, three 1 ml or two 1.5 ml subcutaneously, you get this excellent PK curve with a half-life of 7 to 11 weeks. So again, those of you with a fertile imagination might imagine two drugs that could be put together for treatment, or two drugs not necessarily put together, but maybe independently that could be used for prophylaxis. I don't know how many pharmacists there are out there, but there's an issue here, right? If you're gonna use this subcutaneously, it takes you 4 weeks to get to your target dose, right? So that's a problem. What are you gonna do for those first 4 weeks? It turns out that if you give two doses orally and then a third dose 1 week later, you actually get levels above that target very quickly and then give a subcutaneous dose. And in fact, you can actually give the subcutaneous dose at the same time as you do this oral lead-in and essentially two pills plus a subcutaneous dose, and you're covered for a six-month period. So that is particularly exciting. And our final new drug is a maturation inhibitor. Those of you who have gray hair like me and have been around for a while, you know, we've kind of, flirted with maturation inhibitors. They also interfere with capsid, but in a different way. They block this GAG polyprotein in order for this capsid to assemble, this polyprotein has to be broken into pieces by protease. And if it is broken into pieces by protease, then you get this nice capsid. If you block the protease, so this is not blocking the protease enzyme. So it's not a protease inhibitor. It binds to this particular binding site between P24 and SP1. And by binding there, it blocks the cleavage, and then you have an immature virus that's non-infectious. So this works at one spot, but again, it's a drug protein interaction. And we learned at CROI that this maturation inhibitor is quite potent. You can see that at the higher dose, 200 milligrams, you get a two log effect. At lower doses, the effect is kind of in between. This is a potentially another agent that is active. Now, this is not a single dose. This is not a long acting drug in particular. We might think a little bit about, well, where are we going to use this? How are we going to use it? How does this add to what we have? And I think that's part of what's going on. I think is something that we'll see in the future. Some of the other drugs that I've talked about that are have these different half-lives and very potent low milligram, we can start imagining how we might use them. This drug would likely be very useful in highly drug-resistant patients, and we'll just see how it goes as it's developed. But, and this is a but, With this maturation inhibitor, you can select for resistance. This agent, again, this was presented at CROI. We are going to, it really is going to need to be part of a active multiple drug amendment, multiple drug regimen. We'll learn. We'll have to think about how this is going to be used. Okay, I'm just going to say a brief word about broadly neutralizing monoclonal antibodies. These are very potent antivirals. People talk about them for cure and other things, but they are very potent antivirals. The problem is they're pretty specific, meaning there are variants that aren't susceptible and there are variants that are highly susceptible. But the advantage to these broadly neutralizing antibodies is that they have the potential to be very long acting. You can modify them so that their half-life is on the order of several months. So again, when you're thinking about, well, what if I need partners for long-acting agents? A monoclonal antibody is a potential partner. Now, they can be infused, meaning IV infusion, but they probably can also be injected sub-Q, and that's being studied. So if you think about them as antivirals, it's possible that they could be a component of either therapy or prevention in the future. I think the problem, one problem is, again, is, you know, kind of activity against different variants. We all have variants in our head, right? Oh, COVID-19 variants. Well, HIV, you know, has COVID like blitzed in terms of variants. Within one person, there's more variants than there are in the world with COVID, because HIV is so variable. So broadly neutralizing antibodies are interesting and potentially very useful, but we would have to think about how to use them almost certainly in combination, and we might need actual susceptibility testing to know how to use them. So there is an antibody, a tri-specific antibody. It's an antibody that has three different epitopes where it combines. So it's a single antibody that may be a combination. So we'll see where those go. I think we're all very comfortable with small molecules, and I think we kind of feel like we know how we can use them. I think we'll see about these broadly neutralizing antibodies. Hopefully it's gonna move, it did. I think that we know that this is a study that was done in part at the University of Pennsylvania, at part in the AIDS Clinical Trials Group, looking at two different monoclonal antibodies, VRC01LS and VRC07LS. Turns out VRC07 is both more potent and has a broader range. And what you can see is that a single infusion led to, you know, between a one and a one and two log drop in virus. But these are not different doses, they're just different people. And you can see there were different effects in different people. And that's not surprising, because different people are gonna have different variants. But there is a trial in the AIDS Clinical Trials Group that is studying long-acting cabotegravir given by injection, along with the VRC07 523LS being given as an infusion. So this is as a therapy. This isn't some cure study. It is a therapeutic study to see if this two-agent combination can work as antiretroviral therapy. So in the last half of my talk, I'm going to talk about how these agents may be used. And I think for prevention, what we're going to see as these agents being used as a long-acting, not therapy, really, a long-acting prevention intervention. What are opportunities and challenges for prevention? Well, if we could have very long-acting therapy, it would address the kind of Achilles heel of prevention, which is adherence. And what would be great would be multiple options for administration. And I'll talk about the potential in a minute about what are some options that we're going to be looking at, I think, in the very near future, at least for clinical study. And the challenge is, well, if we're using new agents, especially agents that work by a new mechanism, how are we going to know if they work or not, which I think is really important. How will the studies be done? We know that TDF-FTC and TAF-FTC are actually very effective as prevention. So to compare to them, it takes a very large study. Are there risks? What are the risks of using long-acting agents for therapy? And one of them might be the selection of resistance, which we'll talk about. So there are clearly challenges to developing new prevention agents. And the challenges, I think, are going to get harder because our prevention therapies are going to get more effective. So a monoclonal antibody was tried as a prevention intervention. These are called the AMP studies. The idea here was, could a monoclonal antibody prevent infection given as a infusion to high-risk people? There are two studies that were done that were the called the AMP studies. These are randomized controlled trials of two doses of VRC01. So there was a 10 milligram per kilogram dose and a 30 milligram per kilogram dose in high risk participants every 8 weeks compared to placebo. It was a combination HVTN, HPTN study. So the 085 study, AMP study, was done in high risk men and transgender people in the Americas and Europe. The HVTN 703, HPTN 081 study was done in high-risk women in sub-Saharan Africa. They all got 10 infusions. So that's 20 months of therapy. And in this particular study, it was placebo-controlled. And if the participants had active access to PrEP, they could use it. Many chose not to. And at first blush, you might say, whoa, this is a pretty negative study. The black line is infections in the placebo group. And then these various colored lines are either the pooled, which is this purple in the middle, or low dose or high dose, which are the other lines. And none of this is statistically significant. The estimated effect is different. The numbers are different. They're not statistically different. This is the study done in men who have sex with men, transgender people. And numerically, there were fewer infections in the people that got BRC01, but it wasn't significant. In sub-Saharan Africa, while the differences look bigger, the actual numbers of people randomized were smaller. So the point estimate is not as precise. And none of these differences are significant either. So in the main analysis, it was not effective. But I think there was some suspicion that it might not be effective. And because there was a pre-planned analysis to look at people who became infected with a virus that was sensitive to VRC01. And as it turns out, people infected with viruses that were sensitive to VRC01 were actually protected. The rate was about fourfold lower, or 75% better with the pooled VRC01 compared to placebo. So fewer people were infected with a sensitive virus. And then if the viruses weren't sensitive, there was absolutely no difference. And I think what that tells you is that the concept could work, but you'd have to have either one antibody or a combination of antibodies that would cover most variants. And in this case, that was not the case. Most of the variants were actually resistant to VRC01. So this concept, I think, is farther in the future. We would have to be able to give probably multiple monoclonal antibodies, and there are, you know, cost and other logistic reasons why that might not be feasible, at least not right now, but could be feasible in the future. But what about long-acting injectable? Well, probably most of you have heard about HPTN-083. This was cabotegravir prevention. So this 083 was in high-risk MSM and transgender women in North America, South America, and Asia. And was a large study, 2,200 participants in each arm. And in this particular study, there were substantially and significantly fewer infections in people that received cabotegravir. So it was an every 8 week injection. So it is an intramuscular injection every 8 weeks. So it's not a, a trivial injection. It's a substantial volume, 3 mLs, but it was significantly better than oral TDF-FTC. It was designed as a non-inferiority study, but it actually worked it was superior, as you can see over here. So the bounds of the interval are way beyond superiority, which was way over here. So it was quite effective. And in part, we know, and in this study they showed, that the reason why TDF-FTC wasn't as good, at least for the most part, was people stopped taking their pills or missed pills. And most of these infections that occurred in people on the TDF arm occurred either in people who were adhering poorly or who had stopped therapy. This is a complicated slide, but I'll take a minute to go over it. These are the groups of people who became, these are people, these are all 13 people that, all 13 people that became in, I'll start again, all 16 people that became infected. Four were actually infected at baseline. So they actually had detectable RNA at a low level at baseline. Five were infected essentially after they stopped the injection. You can see many were a year after they stopped. This one stopped, purple is oral therapy. B1 is someone who stopped almost a year out and then became infected. B4 is someone who was on oral therapy, open label TDF, because they stopped their injections. And B5 is again, someone who actually only took oral therapy for a short period of time. So those five are incident infections. They're one of the 12, but they were not receiving therapy. Three became infected while they were still on oral therapy. And at least one of them was probably either was out of pills because they only got 5 weeks worth of oral therapy. And then somewhat surprising, four people who appeared to be taking their injections and getting them on time, were taking their injections and getting them on time, became infected. So very effective, 12 out of 2,200 people became infected on therapy. But of those people that became infected, five developed resistance. One person who was infected at baseline, so that's not too surprising. They had infection and they got a single agent. Two developed resistance during oral lead-in, and two developed resistance despite getting injections on time. So that's really something we have to figure out. I think many people said, oh, the tail, cover the tail. Well, there were no infections there were no resistance out of five infections during the tail phase. That doesn't mean it won't happen, but it didn't happen in this particular study. So there's a big advantage to in terms of adherence by giving every 8 week injections. There is some risk of selecting for integrase resistance. So what about islatravir? Remember, islatravir is that NRTTI, two T's instead of two N's, NRTTI. This is a study in macaques, a really interesting study. They actually gave these macaques high doses of islatravir and challenged them, and they didn't become infected. And then they kept lowering the dose of islatravir. They went down to 0.3 milligrams per kilogram per week and continue to challenge them, and then down to 0.43 milligrams per kilogram per week, continue to challenge them, and all the monkeys were protected. Based on pharmacokinetics, for islatravir, once monthly oral dosing will probably be adequate for prevention interventions, at least by pharmacokinetics, and at least based on a monkey model. And so if you look at an oral dose of 60 milligrams once a month, so this is for prevention, 60 milligrams once a month, and this was presented by Sharon Hillier at R4P, which I think was late January. You can see that that once monthly dosing keeps the concentration, the intracellular concentration, well above the PK threshold, well above the PK threshold, 10 times above the PK threshold, or more than 10 times. And you can, you know, discuss amongst yourselves, or we can discuss if we have time, which I think we will, about whether, well, is once a week better, once a day, once a month, which is better for prevention. Well, you got to prove it works first, and we don't know that it works for prevention. We only know in a small number of monkeys it worked pretty well despite rectal challenge, but we're going to have to prove it. But there are alternatives, and remember, it looks like a implant might last for 6 months or even a year. So you could go once daily, once weekly, once monthly, all oral, or an implant that might last 6 months or a year with islatravir. So that, I think, is pretty exciting, but a lot of work to prove that it all works. So what about the capsid inhibitor? What about lenacapavir? Well, this is a capsid inhibitor in monkeys. It turns out this SHIV is a combination SIV-HIV virus. Certain parts are HIV, certain parts are SIV. Turns out you can't use lenacapavir, you have to use a slightly different capsid inhibitor. So you might not see exactly the same result. So this was a single injection in these monkeys at two different doses. And you can see that all the placebo group became infected over 15 weeks with multiple exposures. And the reason why these lines are getting darker is the exposures got higher. And only when the concentration started to fall did the monkeys become infected. So I think it's worth noting that they did become infected while there were still some drug concentration present. The doses had fallen below that protective level that we saw in the earlier slides. So I think, again, we may have a long-acting injectable that could be used for prevention, and the studies are being planned. So how else might these agents be used? Well, they certainly could be used as therapy. I showed you that islatravir is active against multi-drug resistant variants. And lenacapavir is a new drug and a new target. So we know it's gonna be active. And so these drugs could be used in highly treatment experienced patients. And that was presented at CROI. This was a design that might be familiar to you because this is very, very similar to how fostemsavir was studied. These were people with very substantial drug resistance. They had to have a viral load over 400. They had to be resistant to two or more agents and three or more of the ARV classes. And they had to have less than two fully active drugs. And if they had at least one active drug, they were put into this functional monotherapy group where they got oral lenacapavir. And continued on their failing regimen, or placebo, and continued on their failing regimen. And then everybody got a sub-Q injection. Everybody got lenacapavir. The folks that got oral already got a sub-Q. The folks that got placebo got oral and then a sub-Q injection. and they're optimized, their regimen was optimized. And remember, these people had at least one active agent. Some got fostemsavir, only a small number. A few more got ibalizumab, but also a relatively small number, 11% and 24%. And then there was a non-randomized cohort. This is the group that had no fully active agents in the background, and they just got oral lenacapavir and then a sub-Q injection. And as I mentioned, it's doses, oral doses on day one and day two of 600 milligrams, then a dose at day eight, then an injection on day 15. And that may be changed as we go forward. You probably don't have to space it out quite like that, but that's what was done. And this is what we call a proof of principle study. Is lenacapavir actually active in people with highly resistant virus? And what you can see is the answer is by far yes. It has two logs. A hundredfold decline in viral load. There were three people that didn't meet the 0.5 log change. And two of those three people actually had very low viral loads at entry, so couldn't fall very much. And one was actually, by the time they entered the study, was actually suppressed. So that person obviously couldn't have a decline. So proof of principle that this is an active drug in people with resistant virus. Though the data are not complete, this is just kind of the as treated cumulative data in both the randomized and non-randomized cohort. You can see that 73% of these people who were entered and made it out to 26 weeks were still suppressed, which is, I think, a pretty positive outcome in the study of people with highly resistant virus. We do know in this study, though, that a couple of people, two, did develop resistance mutations. Both were able to resuppress, one without changing therapy, but there was some resistance selection. So kind of keep that in the back of your mind. What about islatravir for treatment experience? Well, the study's ongoing. This is a daily therapy. Again, highly treatment experienced people with resistant virus. And it has two parts, just like the previous study, but there are several different arms, islatravir alone for 7 days, doravirine alone for 7 days, the two together for 7 days, and then placebo, and then everybody gets the two drugs together plus optimized background, and that's open and ongoing, and if you're interested, we could click on this, and you could see the clinicaltrials.gov. It is enrolling patients. These are hard participants to enroll, because fortunately they're not that common. And then we certainly want to combine these drugs for long-acting therapy, not only in highly drug-resistant people with highly drug-resistant virus, but in potentially anybody who would like long-acting therapy. And there is a study of lenacapavir in treatment-naive people where they initiate with oral then sub-Q lenacapavir plus oral FTAF. So this is a mixed subcutaneous oral regimen. I don't think anybody at the sponsor thinks that that's going to be a therapy, but they want to know whether lenacapavir is that anchor agent, right? That has the ability to keep people suppressed on a three agent dual nucleoside regimen. And then at week 28, they're going to then move to a two drug, either lenacapavir with TAF or lenacapavir with bictegravir, to then see how that goes. And that study, I believe, is actually fully enrolled. And then there is another study bringing back those monoclonal antibodies where people who are suppressed, so they're treatment experienced but suppressed, would get lenacapavir and then one of these two and two of these long-acting antibodies. So this is using long-acting antibodies as a therapy. This is not a cure study. This is just giving three drugs. One of them is lenacapavir, and the other two are monoclonal antibodies. And it's just to see whether that will work as a therapy. So it would, if it worked, it would be an every 6 month therapy. So to me, that's an exciting opportunity. And then we know of a trial that's in development and about to open to enrollment. Looking at islatravir plus MK805. So remember, MK805 is that NNRTI that can be given once a week. This is selatravir being given once a week. It is looking at various doses of MK-8507 comparing it to people that stay on their bictegravir FTC TAF. So this is what would be called a phase 2B study, looking to see whether two drugs given once a week, so it's once a week, could be a suppressive therapy. And then it probably won't surprise you to learn that the companies that are making lenacapavir and islatravir have announced an agreement to jointly develop and commercialize their long-acting therapies, lenacapavir and islatravir. I think any of us that heard about these two drugs 2 years ago when they kind of began talking about them, felt that this was a marriage that was almost certainly going to take place. I guess it was just a very long engagement period and maybe some breakups and getting back together. But it appears that they're going to go forward and develop these two long-acting drugs. I don't know exactly how they're going to develop them. Are they going to be injectable and implantable? Are they going to be once weekly? That's something that's going to be decided. Okay, terrific. So now we're to our post-test questions. What time is it? So we really will have time for questions. So, you know, you can like type away in the chat with your questions. But this is the first post-test question. I got to move it out of my way so I can. So this is lenacapavir. What is true about lenacapavir, this investigational agent? It binds to a human protein and stabilizes the capsid. It blocks multiple capsid-dependent steps in the HIV life cycle. It does not select for resistance mutations in vitro, or it can only be given subcutaneously. So go ahead and hit the button and see what you think. I'll give you 10 seconds or so. And we have some great questions coming up. This is a terrific audience. The correct answer is it blocks multiple steps in the capsid-dependent steps in the HIV life cycle. And the vast majority of you got this correct, and I'm very pleased with that. As we mentioned, that's probably why it is so potent, because it blocks multiple steps. So excellent work. I got to close that before I can go forward. This next is a little bit more complicated. So this is about islatravir. Which of the following studies for HIV treatment and prevention are ongoing or planned for the novel agent islatravir? So oral therapy and as a long-acting implant, daily, weekly, monthly oral therapy and as a subcutaneous injection, daily, weekly, monthly oral therapy and a long-acting implant, or weekly and monthly oral therapy and as an IM injectable. So which one did we go through where we saw these different studies that are either ongoing or planned? So go ahead and vote. This has been great. Please keep entering your questions in the chat. We should have plenty of time to answer them. So let's see how we did here. This was a harder question. Wow, the vast majority of you got this exactly right. So remember, we have daily for therapy in highly treatment experienced people. And also there is an ongoing study with doravirine daily, weekly, hopefully in combination with MK-8507 and potentially in combination with oral lenacapavir, monthly as a prevention intervention as an oral therapy. And then this is being formulated as a long-acting implant. I don't know of any plans to formulate it as a subcutaneous injection, though I suppose that might be possible, but I don't know of any plans. So three quarters of you got that answer correct. So excellent, excellent work. So let me move to the questions. We have a few. So one really important question is, what do we do? And thanks for for switching to that. I should have. What do we do in case of allergic reaction to these long acting antivirals? And I think that is an excellent question. that's part of the reason why we have an oral lead in currently for cabotegravir or rilpivirine for treatment and cabotegravir for prevention. But what we're learning is that allergic reactions are very uncommon. One of my questions disappeared. Sorry. Allergic reactions are very uncommon with cabotegravir and rilpivirine, but they could happen. And we use long acting agents in other therapy branches like psychiatry. And for an IM injection, there isn't really anything you can do other than treat the allergic reaction. For islatravir and the implantable, well, the implant can come out. So that's important. I imagine that there'll be an oral lead-in for islatravir and an oral lead-in for lenacapravir until we know how safe they are in terms of allergic reactions. But that's an excellent question. The next question is about the role of BNABs for prevention of mother-to-child transmission. I think that's possible. Again, though, I think we're kind of in the same boat as we are for any other form of prevention. You'd have to use a combination that was covered all the variants possible. And in an adult woman who's chronically infected, there are lots and lots of variants in that setting. I think it could be effective, but you'd probably have to use multiple agents. They are also looking at it as prevention, mother to child transmission, going to the infant. That could work and is being considered again. And the difference there is we know that infants are typically infected with one or a couple of variants. But again, you'd have to pick the right variant. So I am hopeful that we're going to get there. And I'm hopeful with technology, we will be able to manufacture these monoclonal antibodies in a cost-effective way. There was an exciting presentation. It was actually a follow-up presentation at CROI, looking at, instead of giving the antibody, what if you could give the a genetic material for the antibody. So use a vector like the COVID vaccines, the Johnson & Johnson and AstraZeneca are vectored vaccine. But instead of putting in, like in the COVID vaccine, the genetic material for the spike protein, what if you actually put in the genetic material for broadly neutralizing antibodies? So instead of getting the immune system to make them, just get the muscle cells to make them. Surprisingly, that worked. People who got injections with the genetic material for VRC07 had persistent expression of VRC07 for very long periods of time. Now, those were people with HIV. As far as I know, they haven't stopped therapy yet, but it is a technology that could be used. Are there data on patients who missed doses of cabotegravir and did not cover with oral meds? So in the studies of treatment with cabotegravir, certainly in the LATTE studies where we had PK and people were monitored very carefully in LATTE 2, there were people who missed doses. There was at least one example of a person that probably got a dose that didn't end up in the muscle or the fat, might have actually ended up in a vascular space, who had no rilpivirine detectable, even though they got injected. I think we're going to learn over time, about the people who became infected on, the ATLAS study and the FLARE study and the ATLAS 2M study. Well, if you look at their concentrations, on average, they're lower than the median of everybody else. But there are certainly people that stayed suppressed that had similar concentrations. So I think that is a real risk, that cabotegravir in people who then stop taking it, and they have this tail that they might select for resistance. But we don't have much data yet on. I think those data will come from clinical practice, but I think that's a concern, Tim, and is an excellent question. Am I able to comment about how a clinician could prescribe injectable cabotegravir every 8 weeks for PrEP, given the complexity of this agent being non-FDA approved at this time? There are likely hurdles surrounding insurance, et cetera. So, great question. Yeah, I don't think we're going to be able to use cabotegravir as PrEP very efficiently. I suppose a very rich patient that could afford to buy both cabotegravir and rilpivirine and decided then to just use the cabotegravir, you could maybe imagine something different. But I think it'll wait till it's approved. Now, the good news is that, and I didn't mention this and I should have, the 084 study, which was done in high-risk women in sub-Saharan Africa, also showed substantial benefit to cabotegravir every 8 weeks in high-risk women. In fact, if you exclude people who were infected at baseline, there was one woman who became infected out of maybe 1,600 or 1,200. Very, very, very effective in women. I am quite sure that the sponsor of that product is moving forward with the FDA as quickly as they possibly can. And so I think it will be available. Now, when it'll be available, well, certainly I suspect more than 6 months from now, but this is just a guess, I don't know. I think less than a year. I think you won't have it in your hands right away, but you'll have it in your hands someday. The question, this may simply be my own annoyance that having explained cabotegravir/rilpivirine Q-month and then re-explain the new interval when the FDA goes to the longer interval. Why didn't they do every 2 months at the outset? Well, you know, somebody relatively high up in a company had to make a decision. My guess is that person was not a big gambler. And they picked a safe decision, which was if you gave it more frequently, the likelihood that you would select for resistance would be less. And you would be more certain that it would be active, but you would maybe it wouldn't get used as much because, you know, 12 injections a year, 6 injections sounds a lot better. You know, the regulatory agents in Europe said, you can give us the every month data, but we're not going to approve you until we see the every 2 month data. And that's not what the FDA decided. I think that you're going to have to explain it twice. My own approach, and this is just me, it has nothing to do with data, is it's from me looking at data. I'm very likely, if I'm going to start people on the injectable combination for therapy, I am going to probably start with every 4 week, see how the person tolerates it, see how well they are with coming to their appointment, see if they maintain suppression. And then after they've done that for some amount of time, and I don't know what the answer is, switch to every 2 months, but that's just my opinion. Mary Vogelass, are there any preliminary pregnancy data concerns with the new agents? Not as far as I know, and I can tell you that I don't think this is speaking out of school, but the company that's going to study lenacapavir as a prevention intervention is going to let women on the study who become pregnant stay on the study. And you might say, well, it's got a half-life that has concentrations out for a year. So they might as well keep the woman on study because she's gonna obviously be exposed to therapy. But I think it's a very good step forward. So Mike Vinegar asked, do long-acting agents for HIV therapy you discussed have activity against hepatitis B? The answer is no, which is a really important question. As far as I know, none of them do, but I'm blanking on islatravir. I don't think islatravir does. Despite selecting for 184V, I don't think it has any hepatitis B activity. And that'll be a big issue, right? Because we have good examples, as you know, Mike, very well, of people who weren't appropriately screened for hepatitis B, who went on two drug therapy and had reactivation of hepatitis B, or there are case reports of people on two drug therapy that doesn't include tenofovir or 3DC-FTC who become infected with hepatitis B. I did ask, TAF is a very active drug, and tenofovir is very, very, very active against hepatitis B. Could you give TAF once a week along with your lenacapavir and islatravir? And I got a scratch on the head. They said, well, boy, it is really active against hepatitis B. So maybe you could. It's never been studied that way. My guess is it would work, but no one's going to do anything based on my guess. Next question. Any studies looking at combining the maturation inhibitor with a protease inhibitor? Great question. I suspect that'll be on the table. But I don't know of any ongoing studies right now. Given that obesity is a risk factor for cabotegravir or rilpivirine failure, is this related to injection technique and failure to get in the gluteal muscle? If so, is there a recommendation based on BMI? Great question. I don't know the answer to that. I suspect that's correct. Also, I think that's why women probably have a slightly higher risk of confirmed virologic failure than men, because their distribution of fat and muscle is different than men. The risk is pretty small, though. I mean, most people, even big, heavy people, do fine. So I can tell you there's no plans for a BMI-adjusted dose. It's a good question, and certainly it would be worth asking representatives of the company, but as far as I know, there's no plan. I mentioned weight gain. Can I expand on that? There is a small, but I think real increase in weight with cabotegravir. If you look in, at least I know the 083 data better. If you look in men or transgender women in 083 over about a year and a half, there was 1.5, slightly more, kilogram gain. So that would be 3.5 pounds or so. And if you compared it to the people taking TDF-FTC, the gain was less. So I think there is the potential that cabotegravir has some weight gain. In the 077 study in healthy, low-risk volunteers, again, there was about a kilogram of weight gain. So I think it does happen. What about patients that are multi-drug experienced with resistance on a salvage BID regimen now, like a protease inhibitor and opponized background? Can they switch to an STR like the fixed dose of TAF, FTC, darunavir, and cobicistat? I think it depends. I mean, one of the things I do in clinic, I have a lot of people that are my age and have been on therapy since the early to mid 90s. And a lot of them are complicated regimens. And I realize that when I think very carefully, a lot of them can be simplified, but not all of them. But I have patients that were on, fostemsavir, infuvertide and multiple agents who are now on just a single pill of darunavir and rilpivirine, because they never got integrase resistance, and they don't have NNRTI resistance, or only have a 103N. So you can simplify people, but that's something to do very carefully, because if you select for integrase resistance by simplifying, that's a harm to the a patient. The last question, and which is really kind of right on time, how about genotyping resistance testing for the translocation inhibitor? How easy it is to do? Well, it should be really easy because it's just a reverse transcriptase genotype. So that shouldn't be a problem at all. It acts at the RT, at least in vitro and in animals, it only selects for 184V. So that you would get a typical resistance test. Now, when you start giving it to humans, and we know humans, all of us know humans, that people are going to take it wrong. People are going to take too much. People are going to take too little. Whether it might select for other reverse transcriptase mutations is unknown. The sponsors think it won't happen very often, but we don't really know. So we'll see. I'm sorry. I'm being corrected, but the person is 100% correct. I meant dolutegravir rilpivirine, not darunavir rilpivirine. That's my patient that was on very complicated therapy and now is on one little pill. That doesn't happen that often, but it is worth looking at all your patients that are on more complicated therapy. You know, my mantra in clinic is they should be on the simplest, safest therapy that fits into their life. That's obviously effective. So, all right. Just remember this will be on demand. The slides will be available and you can get CME and MOC credit. I don't know if I can get MOC credit. I'd like to. And thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Eron. As a reminder, evaluations and information on how to claim continuing education credits will be emailed by tomorrow, 5 p.m. Pacific time, to enable us to review all of those that have attended today's live broadcast. Upcoming webinars available for sign-up are listed here and may be accessed through the IAS-USA website. And here's a list of upcoming virtual courses. Tomorrow, we do have the first part of the CROI two-day virtual course special. And if you have not yet accessed the CROI abstract ebook, that is available on the CROI conference website. And full and free access to all virtual CROI 2021 presentation recordings and materials will be made available on April 15th. For a list of upcoming dialogues, you may visit our website as well. And we have a dialogue scheduled for next week on an update on early treatment of COVID-19. Lastly, we'd like to thank our presenter, Dr. Eron, the audience for your participation, and to all HIV clinicians working 24/7 to continue to provide care for people with HIV. And this concludes today's presentation.
Thank you.